today, the 5th Sunday after Pentecost. We'll be back here again in Boston, Massachusetts. And the epistle for this 5th Sunday after Pentecost is taken from St. Peter's, first epistle of St. Peter, chapter 3. Dearly beloved, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another, being lovers of the brotherhood, merciful, modest, humble, not rendering evil for evil, nor railing for railing, but contrariwise, blessing. For unto this are you called, that you may inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him decline from evil and do good. Let him seek after peace and pursue it, because the eyes of the Lord are upon the just, and his ears upon their prayers. But the countenance of the Lord is upon them that do evil things. And who is he that can hurt you if you be zealous for good, of good? But if also you suffer anything for justice' sake, blessed are ye. And be not afraid of their fear, and be not troubled, but sanctify the Lord Christ in your hearts. And then the gospel, taking that according to St. Matthew, chapter 5. At that time Jesus said to his disciples, except your justice abound more than that of the scribes and the Pharisees, you shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that it was said to them of old, thou shalt not kill. And whosoever shall kill shall be in danger of the judgment. But I say to you that whosoever is angry with his brother shall be in danger of the judgment, and whosoever shall say to his brother, Raca, shall be in danger of the council. And whosoever shall say, thou fool, shall be in danger of hell fire. If therefore thou offer thy gift at the altar, and there thou remember that thy brother hath anything against thee, leave there thy offering before the altar, and go first to reconcile with thy brother, to thy brother, and then coming thou shalt offer thy gift. That's for the words of today's Holy Gospel. Glory to the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, amen. Today, the 5th Sunday after Pentecost, we have, of course, our epistle and gospel today. Today, a few considerations on the scripture reading that we have in the breviary today from the book of Kings. And a consideration on obedience of the Amalekite that's in the scripture reading today. And the obedience of Judas. And then also the obedience of St. Paul and the followers of Christ. We read about in the book of Kings today that Saul was killed. Saul is dead in battle. And the battlefield was left desolate. And a couple of days after the battle, a man came with sackcloth and ashes on his head and mourning. And he ran into the camp of King David. He said, David, I have terrible news for you. He said, what is that? Saul and Jonathan, his son, are dead. How do you know this? They were killed in battle only a few days ago. And when I came upon the battlefield, I saw King Saul. Seeing that he was about to lose and being wounded, he fell upon his own spear, and he lay upon the ground dying. But he was still very strong, and he was in the greatest pain. And he said to me, take thy sword and fall upon me and kill me, because I cannot take this pain, and I am surely to die. So therefore I took my sword, and I fell upon King Saul, and I killed him, as he had requested, for I saw that he had no life in him, and that he was going to die anyway. I took the diadem off his head and the bracelet from his wrist, and now I have brought it to you. And then David, hearing that Saul and Jonathan were dead, he immediately began to mourn, and he sang a canticle of mourning. And all the people of the camp of Israel, of David, they all mourned until the evening. And he turned to the Amalekite, and he said, who are you? And I am Amalekite, a son of a stranger of Amalek. And he said, why is it that you fell upon the anointed of the Lord? He told me to do it. Did you not know that he is the anointed of the Lord? How dare you raise your hand against the anointed of the Lord? And therefore he commanded, David commanded one of his soldiers to approach the Amalekite and to kill him. And they killed the Amalekites. And it's interesting here in this situation of King David that Saul was his enemy. Saul wanted David dead. Saul put David in exile. And David lived in exile. And he had to flee King Saul. And David had several opportunities in which he could have killed Saul himself. Such as one day when he went and he pulled the sword out of Saul's side. When they were all sleeping. And he went to the top of a cliff and he said, "This is the sword of Saul. You're not a very good guard to protect the king when I'm able to come and take his sword from his side while he's sleeping." And then Saul said, "I'm sorry. I didn't mean to try to kill you, David." He let him escape and then he went home. Saul would try to kill David, then he would allow him back. Then he would try to kill David and allow him back. But when Saul finally died, David was an enemy of Saul. And Saul did not want David to be alive. And he would not accept him anymore. Saul also was the king. And he is not only the king. Remember that at that time in the Holy Mother Church, the Saul was king and prophet. He prophesied on his first day that he met Samuel. And he was the head of the church. Later on, a high priest would take over as the head of the church. He was anointed of God. He was king over the Jewish people. He was the head of the church. And so he made a command to the Amalekites, "I am dying. Kill me." So he pulled out the sword and killed him. And this tells us multiple things. One is that the obedience to the... you don't always obey the prophet. You don't always obey the king. You don't always obey the pope. You don't always obey the bishop. You don't always obey the priest. You don't always obey the head of any organization. And explained very well by St. Peter in Acts chapter 5, when they were all caught for being disobedient, because it was illegal to spread the religion of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, they were thrown in prison. They rejoiced that they might be thrown in prison for the sake of Christ. And when asked about it, they said, "Why are you not obeying the temple laws? The temple laws, why aren't you obeying them? Why aren't you obeying the laws of the state in the matter of your religion being illegal? Why aren't you obeying these laws?" And St. Peter responded, "We obey God rather than men." And St. Thomas Aquinas asked the question, should we always obey our superiors? Because they are representatives of God. Should we always obey the pope? Should we always obey the bishop? Should we always obey the priest? And the simple answer is no. For when the pope, bishop, and priest go contrary to the law of God, then we are obliged to disobey. And we see this in the case of the Amalekite, who is in the scripture reading today. He killed the king in a direct order, under direct obedience to the king. And why did he do it? He did it to stop pain. He did it because there was nothing else that could be done. Furthermore, when the Amalekite killed Saul, he wasn't like the enemies. When the enemies tried to kill Saul, they were very happy to see Saul dead. But the Amalekite mourned Saul's death. The Amalekite did not want to kill Saul. He is the example in sacred scripture of what we call today mercy killing. Can you have mercy killing in the world? Is there anything about it in the sacred scripture? Is there anything about it in the law of God? Yes, there is. For the Amalekite, who liked King Saul, who wanted to be faithful to King Saul, the Amalekite, who honored him and honored his final wishes, killed the king of the church, the head of the church, the pope of the Old Testament. He killed him. And why did he kill him? In order to be obedient, in order to stop pain and anguish, in order to also make a good thing happen, because King Saul was not the kind of king who should be. David would be so much a better king than King Saul. David's so much superior to King Saul. And so there are all kinds of good reasons for the Amalekite to kill Saul. He killed him. He fell upon him and he killed him. He took the diadem of his crown, took the bracelet from his wrist, another symbol of his authority, and he brought them to King David. He came mourning because it was a sad thing. And David said, "You're sorrowful. You mourn King Saul. You're sad that he lost. You protected the crown. You protected the bracelet. So what am I going to do? I'm going to kill you. And he killed him immediately. Because David could only notice one thing. He noticed the thing that 1976, Archbishop Lefebvre noticed in the Holy Mother Church. When he preached his famous sermon in Lille on the 50th anniversary of his priesthood. He preached that sermon in Lille, and he said, I cannot lend my hand to the destruction of the church. They are trying to destroy my church. They are telling me I'm being disobedient by continuing the seminary. They're telling me I'm being disobedient by continuing priests going throughout the world to say the Mass and hear confessions and save the holy priesthood and save the church for the faith. They tell me I'm not doing the right thing and I must be obedient. I must listen to the Holy Father. I cannot lend my hand to the destruction of the church. That's what he saw. For he had the spirit of King David in him. When I was consecrated a bishop, when any bishop is consecrated, in the consecration ceremony, the bishop consecrating says, receive the spirit of David. May you be like David and like Aaron. That we must be like David. And David did not notice the command of Saul. David did not notice that Saul was in great pain. But David did notice that he took the sword, the Amalekite did, and he slew the Saul in his pain, in obedience. He tried to end the pain through obedience. Many people in the Holy Mother Church today are trying to end the pain of the crisis in the church. They're going to end the pain by obedience. What is this obedience? Many times Saul could have been killed by David. David, unlike the Amalekite, had the right to kill King Saul. Because David was already anointed king. A king can kill a king. He was already anointed king. Furthermore, David was already informed by Samuel that Saul is wicked, that Saul is abandoned by God, and because of Saul's wickedness, and because Saul is abandoned by God, God has chosen you, David, to be king, and I am anointing you king. And so he was anointed king as a boy. This was many years later. He had the right to kill King Saul because it was in self-defense. He had the right to kill King Saul because he was a king chosen by God to replace King Saul. But David said no. I will not touch the anointed of God. For even though David was the anointed of God, so also was Saul, the anointed of God. And even though David was the anointed of God, who was anointed specifically and precisely to take Saul's place, David would not touch him. But he also did not obey his ways. He also was not his friend. He also did not act like King Saul. He also fought more bravely and boldly than King Saul, and Saul became jealous of David and wanted David dead multiple times. And David had to flee. He defended himself with an army. He fought with an army. He fought against the Philistines. He fought to defend Israel. And all of his battles were in disobedience. All of his battles were against the king anointed of God. And then even Jonathan, who was the son of Saul, he would secretly send information to David because David was his closest friend. But he still stayed with Saul. He did not go with David. And he fought with Saul. He did not fight with David. And when the day of death came, when the punishment of King Saul came, and it was a punishment from God, for Saul went to a witch the night before his death, disguised as an ordinary soldier. He didn't want the witch to know that he was the king. And he came before the witch and said, what's going to happen in the battle tomorrow? And he said, the first thing is you're deceiving me because you're not an ordinary soldier. You are the king. And you are the king of the true religion. And you are the king under the true God. And you're coming to a witch. He was the Pope of the Old Testament. He was the head of the church. anointed of God. And he came to a witch to ask advice. He came to a witch to ask what was going to happen. And the witch had more wisdom than he did, for she said to him, first of all, thou art a king. You try to pretend like you're not a king, but you are. Just like in our times, many people claim that Francis only calls himself the Bishop of Rome. He doesn't call himself the Holy Father. He doesn't act like he's the Holy Father, but he is. Saul on the last night before he died didn't act like a king. He didn't act like the head of the church, but he was. And even though some of his friends did not want to accept him, the enemy still knew, for the witch was a servant of Satan. She wasn't a servant of God. But an angel appealed to her and let her know, that's the king. And he's asking you advice, I'm going to tell you the truth. And so she told him, you're going to die tomorrow. You're going to be killed tomorrow because of your sins. Against your own God. I don't even believe in your God, and I know you will fail in your God. And your God is a true God. Why are you coming to me for advice? I'm not going to help you. You are going to die tomorrow, and also your sons, and your seed shall be wiped out. And all those things happened. He was killed the next day. His sons were killed. The remainder of his sons were crucified a little bit later, and his seed was completely wiped out. God was very angry with Saul. From this we get the Holy Mother teaching, the Holy Church is teaching the church, that the Pope, who is the head of the church, he can be judged by no man. Prima sedes anemine judicator, is how we say it in Latin. The first seed shall be judged by no man. No man has a right to condemn the person of the Pope. This is one of the evils going on in the church today, and a very big difference between now and the 1970s. In the 1970s and late 60s, all traditional Catholics really didn't like Paul VI. Paul VI was the Pope who brought in the new Mass, drove priests out of their churches, brought in the heresies of Vatican II. He was most likely a Mason, and he did great evil in the church. He pushed it down the throat of everyone with an iron fist. But in 1974, when Archbishop Lefebvre wrote his declaration, he said, the only way to remain faithful to the Holy Father, Pope Paul VI, the only way to remain faithful to him is to resist all these wicked implementations that came from the council, to repudiate completely the heresies that came from the council, and to stand firm against them and resist the Rome of neo-modernist and neo-Protestant tendencies until the light of faith shines over Rome again. It's the only way to be faithful, to be obedient to the Holy Father, Pope Paul VI. Notice how he spoke of the Holy Father, who was extremely wicked. Come forward 50 years, 60 years. Come forward 50 years, 1970, 2020, and we find a different attitude of the friends of God, the so-called friends of God. Everyone wants to say how bad Pope Francis is personally, how wicked he is, how he's an unworthy Holy Father. He assigns wicked men and puts them in charge of dioceses. He crushes all the good guys. He punishes, except for the Society of St. Pius X. He's nice to them. He's nice to the SSPX. He's mean to everybody else. He says wicked things. And what is happening? This man is not worthy of being Pope. Maybe he's not the Pope. And the question is spreading throughout the Novus Ordo now. Just like it did back in the 1970s, many Catholics are scandalized at the person of Paul VI. They said, he can't be the anointed of God. There's no way he can be the anointed of God. He's talking to witches. He's putting Buddhas on top of tabernacle. He's allowing the largest mosque to be built in the world in Rome. Paul VI allowed a mosque to be built in Rome. He's praying with the Muslims. Each of the popes did some scandalous thing against the first commandment from Paul VI all the way until today. It's not a specialty of Pope Francis. Three Assisi meetings by John Paul II. worshiping with pagan religions, asking pagans for advice. In the very council itself, they called in the seven witches in order to give advice for the six Protestant observers, six witches, to give advice on how we're going to make a better mass. Does it have precedent in the history of the church? Oh, yes, it does. For the head of Holy Mother Church, in the time of great battle, when he was about to be punished by God, went to a witch and asked advice. And by the way, the witch told him the truth. The one that held the truth spoke a lie. The one that's a liar spoke the truth. And this is happening in the world today. It's the Protestants. It's the idiots, the atheists, people that don't believe in anything except for their paychecks. They are the ones who are talking about the truth of what's going on in the church today, what's going on in the world today. But those on the inside of the Holy Mother of the Church, they don't know. But consider the situation of King David when he decided to kill the Amalekites. He could have been king already many years before. Remember when he was a young man, they said, the people said, Saul killed his thousands, but David killed his tens of thousands. Then David could have done what his son Absalom did. He could have sent criers out amongst the Jews and said, let it be known, David is king. David was anointed of God. David was blessed by Samuel. And Saul is cursed. And the people would have followed him all over the world, all over Israel. He would not have had to fight for his kingdom. David would not have had to fight. David would have been peacefully in his kingdom. Saul would be killed and put away. But he would not touch the anointed of God. He waited many years. And when the years were finished, they forgot about the man that killed Goliath. They forgot about the soldier that killed his tens of thousands. They forgot about how popular David used to be. And when he became the true king, many people said, we're not going to follow you. And he had to fight for years to establish his kingship. War was the hallmark of his reign. He had to fight to establish his kingship. He had to flee his own son. When the time came to establish himself as king, then his son Absalom took over his spot, and he had to flee for his life. Then he had to come back, and he fought all the way until he died. That was the life of King David. Conflict and war, difficulties and challenges. But in them, he would never lay hands upon the person of King Saul. Look at the situation of the church today. You can see the foundations of the expulsion of Pope Francis underway. He is a wicked pope. He is a bad person. He needs to be thrown out. Wicked Pope Francis needs to be thrown out. We've got to get rid of him. He's too bad. No, he is the anointed of God, as King Saul was. Whatever evil things he does, he shall be judged by God. What are we to do? We are to do exactly what Archbishop Lefebvre did and what King David did. We shall not lend our hands to the destruction of the church. We shall not obey his false and wicked command to celebrate the new mass. We shall not follow the false doctrine of Paul VI given to us at Vatican II. We shall not implement the new code of canon law. We are not going to follow the wicked ways and the wicked manner, the wicked principles that came from the council. We're not going to accept them. But we will not lay hands upon the Holy Father. Yet God alone shall judge him. He remains the Holy Father. And now all the talk shows and all the conservatives, Michael Voris said in the very beginning, you can attack anybody, but don't attack the Holy Father. But then he lost all kinds of following. He lost all kinds of support. So he said, okay, we can attack the Holy Father now. I checked my bank account. It's okay. When it becomes popular to attack the vicar of Christ, don't think Christ is behind it. When it becomes popular to do these things, Christ is not behind it. We are not here to attack the vicar of Christ. We disobey his wicked commands. We condemn his wicked statements, as St. Paul did.
When St. Paul saw that St. Peter was doing the wrong thing, when he was jeopardizing the faith of all the Catholic Church from the very beginning by falsely mixing it between the old Jewish religion and the new Catholic religion, by allowing the Judaizers to have too much influence in the Catholic Church, to bring in baptism along with circumcision together, and he was thereby undermining the whole Catholic Church and the whole New Testament, St. Paul resisted St. Peter to the face, and he told him that he was to be blamed. St. Peter backed down. But St. Paul never once said he wasn't the Holy Father. He never once brought up, by the way, this isn't the first time you screwed up, Pete. This isn't the first time. Remember when you denied Christ before that girl? Remember you denied Christ three times? You've got a track record. And so they're going to go through the track record of Pope Francis. He's got a track record. He was cruel as a priest. He was cruel as a bishop. He was cruel as a cardinal. He is friends with the Masons. He's done bad thing after bad thing. And what's going to be the conclusion of all that? We've got to get him out. I don't think he's the Pope. David considered all the wicked actions of Saul, including Saul trying to kill David multiple times. Remember one time, Saul said, David, I like your music. I like your poetry. I like the way you play the harp. And I feel depressed all the time. Can you play your harp? And he played his harp, and he played his harp. And he was playing some emotional, beautiful song. And while he wasn't looking, Saul took a spear himself, and he threw it at David to kill him while he was playing the harp. If you think about it, that's not nice. Shouldn't really do that. And David dodged the spear at the last second, because he didn't see it to the last second, and he ran away, and then Saul sent soldiers to kill him. That's not very good. That's not very honorable. And yet the thought of killing King Saul never crossed the mind of David because of one reason and one reason alone. He's the anointed of God. He was chosen by God to be the head of the holy church, the true church of the Old Testament. No one can lay a hand on the anointed of God. And we teach in the New Testament, King Saul was the anointed of God. But he was not anointed like Pope Francis is anointed. The anointing of Pope Francis is far more holy. For instance, King Saul was the head of the church, but you didn't have to be connected to Saul to go to heaven. But Francis is the head of the church. And only one of the church teaches, thou art Peter, upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And no one can go to heaven who is not connected to the rock of Peter. Now, why are we connected to St. Peter? Is it because he's a great guy? No, it's because he is the successor of St. Peter. Because many of the St. Peters, or his successors, have been very wicked men. Most have been average losers. But some have been wicked men. A few have been saints. Very few beyond average. But these men who were made the head of our Holy Mother, the Church, they stood in the place and they stand in the place of St. Peter. They are the vicar of Christ on earth. They are the anointed of God. We cannot lend our hands to the destruction of the church. We have to make sure that we fight against the destruction of the church. We cannot obey false commands. We have to take an army off in the wilderness against the will of the Pope. And we have to continue to fight the Philistines. What kind of army you fight the Philistines? Saul doesn't approve of your army. We have to fight the Philistines, whether Saul approves of it or not. And so he fought the Philistines. And so in our present crisis in the church, we can't follow false obedience. And remember Judas, very briefly Judas, we'll not do long in the first part. Judas denied Christ a year and a half before he died. At the time of John chapter 6, when Christ said that he was going to, you have to eat my flesh and drink my blood. And all the crowds left him. They all left him. As Eugene says, and the crowds never came back. He lost the crowds. The gospel also tells us, some of the 72 disciples, they left him and they walked with him no more. It also happened because this is a hard saying that we have to eat your flesh and drink your blood. I tell you the truth, it's not hard to eat his flesh and drink his blood. But what is hard is you have to die first. You have to be crucified first. And that is a very hard saying. And some of his disciples walked away. And then our Lord turned to his apostles and he said at the end of the chapter, John, very, very long chapter, he said, will you leave me also? But one of the apostles was Judas. And our Lord, St. Peter, said, Lord, to whom shall we go? And then in the response, St. Peter, our Lord said, did I not choose you 12? I chose 12 of you, and one of you is a devil. This is when he calls one of the apostles a devil. It's on this day that Judas denies Christ, almost 2 years before the crucifixion. One of you is a devil. And so, and then St. John mentions, and that is because Judas, who would betray him, was there. All 12 apostles were there. So the apostles were split because of the crucifixion and the Blessed Sacrament. The disciples were split. The crowds abandoned him, and they never came back. But during the next 2 years, Judas was absolutely perfect. He was so perfect that he took care of the money, he took care of the finances. He acted as all the other apostles. He was very motivated. He was extreme. He did perform miracles as the rest of them did. He listened attentively to all of Christ's teachings. He was beyond reproach. He was perfectly obedient. He stayed in the church, says Bishop Sheen. He stayed in the church. He was obedient. He was perfect. And even when we arrive at the very end, when our Lord said, this night one of you is going to betray me, and then Judas went out, they thought he was going to prepare the supper. They thought he was going to prepare for the temple worship. They thought he was going to prepare for Mass. They thought he was going to prepare for the liturgy. And they thought he was going to feed the poor. Some apostles thought he was going to feed the poor. Other apostles thought he was going to prepare the liturgy. So what does the Satan look like? And remember, says Bishop Sheen, this is exactly after, immediately after, the gospel tells us, and Satan entered Judas in a most demonic way. What did he look like? No pitchfork? No flaming tail? No fire? He looked like a sacristan. He looked like a social worker. He did not look wicked. He looked very good. And when he went out to do good, what did it appear to be? He was going out to prepare the worship. He was going to be like the Institute of Christ the King. He was going to make sure we got more incense, and we got more nice surplices, and we got more beautiful vestments, and we got a nicer choir than the famous choirs we have. Here he is. That's our choirs. But they have a beautiful choir. And they're going to have a magnificent everything outside. It's all beautiful. They're going to do something good. They are Judases. And they're going to be social workers. They're going to go and take care of the poor. They're going to do good things. Are they? And Bishop Sheen concludes, they're going to betray Christ. Obedience is being used by them to cover the wickedness that they are doing. And obedience is being used by the Amalekite in order to justify a bright future. The Amalekite is not wicked. The Amalekite is not a Pharisee. He's not vicious. He's not Judas. But he realizes, if I killed Saul in obedience, and I weep over it, and I bring the crown to David, I'm going to get a pretty good spot. I'm going to get a good position. It's going to be good for me. I'm going to survive. David killed the Amalekite. God said of Judas, better that he would not have been born. But Archbishop Lefebvre, in obedience to the spirit of King David and the manner of David, and all true Catholics say, no, we will not lift our hand to attack Pope Francis. We're not lift our hand to attack and destroy him personally. But we stand firm against the things that he's doing that are bringing destruction to the church. When he says, take a sword and slice the mystical body, I will not obey. When he says, kill me to end the pain, I will not obey. We will stand for the truth and be obedient to Christ. And then when he comes to kill us, we escape. And we fight against the Philistines. And the time will come in God's own choosing where he will be judged by God, not by us. And our time of being brought back in shall come. And like that of King David, there's going to be conflict and battles. But in the meantime, let's imitate David and not follow the fault of the fall of the error and the evil of the Amalekite or that of Judas with the false obedience. Closing, God bless you all. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Amen.